This is Minnie Haikes, known as Concetta Haikes. We come from a very poor family from Italy. We had nothing. They came from Italy, and my mother couldn't stand it here, so she went back to Italy. Well, then finally, her brother-in-law was a priest, and he said, you belong with your husband in the United States. So my mother came to the United States, and she stayed there. Now, we didn't have much in our home there. We didn't have electricity or anything like that. No carpets on the floor or anything like that. We were poor. My father worked in construction. He helped build St. Lucy's Church. My aunt, she was very good. She was my mother's sister. And she said, you won't have to worry about anything when he's not working. And she used to give us flour. She used to give us everything. She bought me clothes and all that. She was very good to my mother. They were two brothers married two sisters. I had Nick, Joseph, Carl, Sam, and who was the other guy? Vince. And we were pretty good. They played ball and little games, you know, hide and seek and all that. We didn't have any of that stuff that they have today, all these trucks and everything. We had nothing. And at Christmas time, we just got one little thing, and that's all, because we didn't have any money. When my father was out of a job, he was out of a job until the next job come up. We used to go in the 10-cent store and get a little doll, 10 cents, and we used to make little dresses with paper, you know? That's about it. We didn't have much. Didn't have much at all. We used to play buttonies and all those things, and we used to take a peach stone and, you know, rub it and make a ring out of it and all that stuff, you know? Nothing like today. Today they have all these toys and toys and toys. And we had all these little things that we used to make. And we used to have like a box and put wheels on it and go riding in that instead of a sled. We used to take a big thing and sit on it and slide down the hill. We didn't have sleds. And we went skating up at the Armory. I didn't know how to skate. I didn't know how to do any of those things, ride a bicycle or anything. But we went. Swimming, I didn't swim. My mother said, you'll die. So we didn't swim. My mother was the boss. My father was the little guy, but he did everything she said, and he was very good to her to the end. I would have liked them to be more outgoing, and they weren't the type that would hug you and kiss you, you know. They were more like parents. Not like today, they talk to them, they read to them, and all that. They couldn't do all that. And when we were promoted, my mother used to say, a little birdie told me, you passed, you know? And that was it. They were good, but they weren't outgoing, like going to school or anything like that. They didn't go to meetings or anything like that. I had to depend on my cousins next door to go to the meetings, and they used to sign my report card because my mother and father didn't read or write English, you know? But it was mostly my cousins. I really lived with my cousins next door. I used to stay with them because I had the five brothers, and then I stayed with them, my cousin Margaret and Jill and Jenny and Catherine. And my aunt was very good to them. My mother and to me. mother was bedridden, and she had to have this box with the light on it for her leg on account of the gangrene. So that's how she died. Well, then my father died 11 months to the day that she died. And she died in 1950, and he died in 1951. And he was good to her. He did everything for her. And I think he must have died from a broken heart, you know, because he had nothing to do but take care of her. I liked school. I started in the sixth grade because 16 school had caved, and I had to go to 14th school. So then when that was repaired, I went to 16th school, and I graduated from 16th school. And my brothers graduated from there. Then I went to a technical high school for 3/4 of a year, and then I quit. And I went to work in a dress factory for just a short time. And that was it for my education. And I only worked for a short while in a dress factory, and I made $7 a week. I was sewing snaps on or buttons on, or I didn't work at a machine. I quit school because I didn't like technical. And that was a shame because even my teacher said, Minnie, she said, you're such a good student. She says, why are you quitting? And I just didn't like it. But I did love 16th school. I loved it. I was valedictorian of the class when we graduated. So that was my life. Then I didn't work since then. I wanted to be a teacher, but never. I'd go with Margaret. She was going with this Billy Barrett. And then there was this fellow that worked at the Boston Steam Dye Works. And he was Billy's friend. And he had a new car in Itzel. And he used to come around, and we used to go out together, Margaret and Billy and Eddie and I. And then he wanted to get married. He said he was crippled in the one leg. He wanted to get married. He said, let's get married. And I said, no. I said, I can't get married, you know. So then that broke up. Then I went with this Tony, which he was a nice guy, Tony Scombardi. And he wanted to be my boyfriend. And he says, you can be my girlfriend. You can go out with somebody else, but just so I know you're mine, you know? But I didn't bother with him, you know? He was nice, an Italian. And then I got with this Huntley. Well, I was with him for a while. Then he moved to Washington, D.C. So that finished that, because his parents went to Washington. So that finished that. So then I met Charlie, come down the center, I've come down the store, hanging around, and I got mixed up with Charlie. And that's how I got Charlie. He lived with his father, and he didn't have his mother was dead, his sister was up in Jessup, and he used to come around the store, hang around, pester me, and all that sort of stuff, you know. That's how I got mixed up with him. And then he'd come, you know, and come by the house and whistle, you know, and I'd be upstairs in bed, you know, and whistle. He was a pain in the neck, you know, but that's what happened with him. But it turned out good. Well, he used to come around and we'd sit on the box there and we'd sing all those old songs. He had a nice voice. And he took me out the one time we went to some beer garden and he sang, It's a Long, Long Time, you know? And I danced and all like that. And that was nice.
Just kiss me once, then kiss me twice, then kiss me once again. It's been a long, long time. Haven't felt like this, my dear, since can't remember when. It's been a long, long time.
Oh, yeah. He went fishing. Hunting, not too much. But he used to go fishing for bullheads. And the one time he had the boat, oh my God, he had so many fish. And I said, you're going to clean those fish. They're son of a gun to clean, bullheads. But they were delicious fish, bullheads. He used to go night fishing. He used to hop the trains. He and John Stanko, they used to hop the trains, you know, and they go fishing at night. Oh yeah, I forgot about that fishing. He was great for fishing. We didn't have a wedding. We just went to the courthouse, Margaret and Billy and Charlie and me. And then later on, we got married in the church. And we didn't have a wedding, like, you know. They didn't propose. He just, you know, just come on. He was ornery. He'd get mad and stay mad, which that lasted almost all our life. But other than that, he's a good provider, good to the kids, and I never had to worry about a dollar when he was working because I was the boss. He'd give me the money and all that. So he was a good provider. World War II, my one brother was Guadalcanal. My other brother, Nicky, was in Germany. My brother, Carly, was in Italy. They served overseas. And that's about it. They served quite a while. And they all come home safe. That was one good thing. He was inductive in 1940. What the heck? Just before the war ended, in 45, I think it was. And then he was released in August of the same year. So he only served about 4 months, 5 months. I didn't like the idea of the war, but what was I going to do? It was something that had to be. How did it happen? How does it happen? Well, I had the one, then 2 years later I had the other, 2 years later another one, 3 years and something another one, then three something another one, and then 2 years another one. So there were six there. That was enough. How did you manage? You just managed. They come there. It was a lot harder than it is today. You had to boil the bottle, boil the nipples, do all that stuff. Today, all you do is get pampered. You used to wash the diapers by hand. Then when we got the washer, we had the washer. But now they put pampers on, and the formula comes in bottles. It was hard then. Well, they're all smart, that's one thing. They're all pretty smart. Butchie, Bonnie, Eugene, you, Cookie, and Marilyn. They're all intelligent and good to live with and very good to me. All I want is for them to get along. And when I'm gone, I don't want any bickering between one and the other. That's all I want. Because I know how it gets, you know, when boys and girls get together, this one's against this and that. But I don't want that. I don't want any of that. But I mean, what concerns me more is my children. And then the grandchildren, naturally, they have their parents and their parents. So it's up to them to take care of them. And I hope nothing comes, you know, wrong with them. That, you know, today the way things are, the way the kids are today, you don't know what's gonna happen. I don't know what I think when I look at all those kids. How did it happen? I can't believe it. When they told me I had cancer, it didn't bother me. It really didn't. I thought, well, if that's what it is, it is. Well, thank goodness it, you know, went away. And then with your father, well, that was of the brain. That was, I really didn't think he was that bad. Until, you know, when they put him in the, whatchamacallit, you know, that, here, the, what do you say, when the nurse is coming out. That's when I thought, well, geez, he's bad, you know. Well, after he passed away, what could I do? I just had to make the best of it. It's tough. It's tough now. It's even, sometimes I think it's worse now than it was in the beginning. Since he passed away. I don't know, it seems like you're thinking of it, you know, even when you're dreaming. And then you think, you look around and he's not there. You know, and it seems like he's supposed to be there. And the same thing with my parents, too, like it. I'm sleeping and all, you know, and I think, well, I'll go and tell them this and that. It's terrible. It's terrible. I am 91 going on 92. And I never thought I'd live to this age. Never. My mother died at 64, my father died at 89, and there's only me and Nikki left. Well, the happiest day, I guess, is when Pushy was born, and the saddest was when my mother died, and my father died, and all these other people that died. There's not one of the family next door, my cousin, now, one is left. The only one that's left is Adele and I, that we can refer back, and my brother. Refer back to the old times, you know? There's nothing. Everything is good, but what bothers me more now is because I feel I'm not much good, you know? I don't feel all that great. And sometimes I wonder how much more, you know? Oh, it was great, yeah. It was great as long as it lasted. But you know, you get tired. You get tired. Think well of me, that's all. All of them.
Times have changed, and we've often rewound the clock since the Puritans got the shock when they landed on Plymouth Rock. If today any shock they should try to stem, instead of landing on Plymouth Rock would land on them. In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was a looked on as something shocking, but now God knows anything goes. Good authors too, who once knew better words, now only used for letter words, writing prose.